Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, my Lord. Thank you, my Lord. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Come on, bless the Lord with me. Brother. Thank you, Jesus. Man, you've heard enough word today to save China and all the Philippine Islands. Glory to God. Amen. Whew. I am high on the gospel. Thank you, Lord. Yes, thank you, Lord. I must touch on this before we go into the Word. How many of you here were in Brother Creflo's service today? Man, see? Yeah. Now, I have a question to ask you. Why did God... When the people said, we want to do this thing our way. Now, why did he yield to that? Now, you have to see covenant through his eyes. He has always. From the very beginning, been totally willing to do everything good he said he would do, to do everything for you he ever said he would do, to do everything he ever planned before anybody sinned.
Yes, sir.
That's right.
And he still is. But when you see covenant through his eyes, he is willing to do for you everything he said he would do.
Hallelujah. Yeah. Hallelujah.
But by covenant, he can only do what you say do. That's the reason it's so important for you to say the same thing he said.
Right.
Instead of something you made up.
Yes,
and some of you look at me like I just crawled out from under a bus somewhere. No, I read this book all the time.
Yes, thank you.
Well, did you ever read the phrase, I judge you by the words that come out of your own mouth? Jesus said, the words that I speak unto you. Let's go back and read it again. John chapter 14. Folks, I'm telling you, now, we have been indoctrinated by Babylonian-based religion, not the Word of God. And by being indoctrinated by that, turn to John chapter 14. By being indoctrinated by that, we were not paying attention to what the Word actually said, but what we thought it said.
Yes, sir.
See?
Yes, sir.
Now, remember this. Jesus said, he that denies me before men, I have to.
Yes, sir.
I have to deny you before the Father. Why? Because you said it. He's not doing what he said. He's doing what you said. He will always do what he said. And he said he would do what you said.
That's right.
That's right.
I know you're kind of swallowing hard and all that, but hey, it's time to get back in the book. You know why? Because like Brother Creflo said, hey, the thing's already done. The price is already paid. I mean, the money's in the bank.
Amen. Amen.
It's a matter of transfer.
Yes, sir.
It's not a matter of God doing anything. I'm going to say this to you. I heard this said by Kenneth E. Hagin 46 years ago, and then it's still so big in my spirit. I'm still studying it. I'm still living by it. He said, God's already done all he's going to do about your healing. He's already done all he's going to do about saving anybody.
Amen. That's right.
Well, God. No, wait a minute. He's already done it. Oh, well, then you mean everybody's saved. No, those that receive it.
That's right.
Put it into action. Righteousness has come upon all men.
Amen.
Where'd you get that? I got it out of the book of Romans. Where you been? I'm picking on you a little bit this morning. But it's time to pick on you. Amen. And if I'm getting on your toes, that's my job. You got them stuck out there. And I'm gonna pray for you and receive your healing, will you? But I'm going to get on your toes about this.
Thank you.
Amen. That's the name of this game. God gets on me and I get on you. And that's the way it works out, you know. Amen. Now, see, he's already done all he's going to do about saving anybody. Now, don't misunderstand that statement. He is still leading. He's still guiding. He's still bumping. He's still maneuvering you around. But salvation is already there. The price has already been paid. Healing always comes. Jesus never misses a meeting.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All you have to do is, the shortest salvation on record was by one of the meanest men to the body of Christ on record. His name was Saul of Tarsus. And Jesus showed up to stop him one way or the other. This is over with, boy. This is the end of it right here. It can be the end of you. Or it can be a new beginning for you. He said, why are you persecuting me? He didn't say, why you persecute the Christians? Why you persecute the body of Christ? He said, why are you persecuting me? You see, Jesus takes that very personally. He said, why are you persecuting me? You remember what Saul said? Lord! That's it right there. He called him Lord. See, he didn't. Salvation was already in place.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Well, what about all that sin, Brother Copeland? Jesus already dealt with that.
Yes, sir.
The confession of the unsaved is not the confession of his sin.
Yes, sir.
The confession of the unsaved is Jesus as Lord. Hallelujah! I don't preach. Be happy. Amen. I can't do this no longer. Thank you, sir. I appreciate you, man. Everything that God's called you to do and everything he has assigned to you will come to pass. And the Lord, by his word, has instructed me to remind you of the soldier's promise and the soldier's psalm. Amen.
Amen.
God said in the book of Numbers, he that goes to war armed before the Lord shall return.
Amen.
Shall return and be guiltless before God and before the nation. You know these things. I know you know these things. But the Lord just wanted to publicly announce today before heaven and earth that you are his man. Give the Lord praise. Give the Lord praise, I said. Give the Lord praise. Glory. Oh, glory to God. Oh, man, I can't let you alone. Oh, that's one fine young man. Praise God. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Man, I'll tell you what, I love what I do.
Hallelujah.
I used to say, you know, I'd do this if I wasn't even called. No, I wouldn't be having much fun at it if I'm doing it and not called. But I have learned that whatever I'm called to do, go do it, because you're going to love it, man. I don't care what it is. If God calls you to do it, then that's where your grace is to go do it. Now then, where was I?
John 14.
Yeah, that's where I was. Thank you, sir. Amen. 14th chapter of John. Notice what Jesus said here now. Believeth thou not that I'm in the Father and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself. Now go back to John chapter 5. Do you remember the scripture that says, and Jesus spoke the word of God, therefore God gave him his spirit without measure?
Yes, sir.
Well, now, listen to that. God, he only spoke what he heard his Father say, so there was no measure put on the Spirit of God. It was full out because he only said what he heard the Father say, and he only did what he saw the Father do. So he said what the Father said, and the Father said what he said, and the Father that dwelt within did the work.
Uh-huh.
Now the same thing's available to you and me. But we've been saying a whole lot of other stuff. Amen.
Sorry.
Well, all right. Now, here we go. Now, notice this. In the 5th chapter of John's Gospel, 19th verse, the Son can do nothing of himself but what he sees the Father do. For what things soever he does, these also the Son does likewise. Can you see how they in perfect sync, in perfect agreement all the time? Yeah, but Brother Copeland, that is Jesus. I understand that. I've been reading this book a long time. I've figured that out by now. That was Jesus. I do know that. I do understand that. But that ain't no excuse for you and me. Because everything he did as a man in the Word. Baptized in the Holy Ghost, anointed of God, he didn't say, I won't do anything on my own. He said, I can do nothing on my own. His own effort was not involved. Never did anything on his own. Not one time.
Yes, sir.
Well, yeah, but Brother Copeland, I mean, that was Jesus. He was tempted a whole lot more than you ever been. Amen. Or ever will be. Everything he did by the power of the written word of God and leadership of the Holy Spirit. He did it on the grace of God. They wondered at the gracious words which he spoke. Amen. Now then, let's go today. Oh, thank you, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah. Open your Bibles with me today to Matthew chapter 4. Matthew chapter 4. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And let's look at the 23rd verse. Let's back up to the 17th verse. From that time, Jesus began to preach. Aha! Most Christian people, when whatever image they have in their mind, about Jesus and however they see him. Most of them don't know he's a preacher. They just see him kind of walking around barefooted with this kind of gold circle around his head. Little pointed toes. Some of them see him with a sheep over his shoulder. Where'd they get that? Sunday school pictures on the wall. And little quarterlies and things. Now, how come is it they know what? All of them can draw you a picture of Mickey Mouse. Ain't got a clue what Jesus looked like. Now, why is that? Well, they pay more attention to Disney during the week, and then on Sunday go to Sunday school and you know, and see all this stuff, and never have had anything to renew their mind. They still have the same picture in their mind about Jesus they had when they were 5 years old. And here they are, you know, 51. I'm telling you, this is important. Now, Jesus, very much of a man. What man do you know that could take a whipping by the cat and by all other kinds of meat? I mean, he was rotted, he was whipped, and slash his flesh off his bones. He got whipped with fists. He got kicked. He got beat. Blood ran from his head. Blood, it started out running through his pores by resisting the devil. And then shout with a loud voice. This a no wimp of a man. Very much of a man. Amen. Oh, he thrills me when I see him. He's a preacher. He began to preach and to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven, read that out loud, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And Jesus, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw two brethren called Simon Peter and Andrew, his brother, and so forth. Now look at verse 23. Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom. Now notice, notice. Are you looking?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes.
Put your eyes on that. Preaching the gospel of the kingdom. That's first, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
He preached the gospel of the kingdom.
Yes, sir.
And healing all manner of sickness, all manner of disease among the people.
Glory.
Yeah.
He didn't just go in there healing.
Yes, sir.
He preached the word.
That's right.
He preached the gospel.
Yes.
What happened? Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God.
Yes, sir.
All right. Let's go over to the 6th chapter of Mark's gospel. Verse 2, on the Sabbath day he was come, he began to teach in the synagogue. Well, now what do you think he's doing? Same thing. Amen. He's teaching what? Teaching the gospel of the kingdom. We'll see that again in a moment. And many hearing him were astonished, saying, where'd this man get this? What wisdom is this which is given unto him that even such mighty works are wrought by his hands? Is not this the carpenter son of Mary, the brother of James and Joseph, Judas and Simon? Are not his sisters here with us? And they were offended at him. Verse 5. And he could there do no mighty work. Didn't say he wouldn't do it. Said he could do it. Huh?
Yes, sir.
Now what happened? He preached the gospel of the kingdom. He said, the words that I speak unto you, they're not my own. The Father that dwelleth within me, he does the works. But they said something else. Who's he think he is coming here telling us all this kind of stuff? That's Joseph and Mary's little boy. He come down and fixed the door on my chicken house one time. word kind of work its way back to you certain times. And years ago, one of my kin folks said, you think Kenneth speaks for God? And one of my cousins said, well, yeah. He said, you think he's a prophet? And my cousin said, yeah, I do. He said, why, he's our kinfolk. I got news for you. Every prophet was somebody's kinfolk. And most of them kinfolk didn't pay no attention to them. But I have to say, I am blessed. God has been faithful to my family, to my mother's prayers, and my dad's prayers, and my grandmother's prayers, and my great-grandmother Owens's prayers. Glory to God. And old G.W. McDonald was a circuit-riding preacher back there. Praise God. God has been faithful, and our family serves the Lord Jesus Christ. And I have, I'm so humbled by it, and I'm so thrilled by it. I enjoy honor in my family. Glory. And I thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. But now, can you see what happened there? It said he could do no mighty work. He spoke the word of God. The power was there to heal. The power was there to do the work. But instead of generating faith, it generated dishonor among them. And he laid his hands on a few folk. He did it anyway. Because, there's a kinfolk, man. He knows these people. He's raised around his feet. He wanted them to get it. You mean to tell me Jesus ever laid his hands on somebody and they didn't get it?
Sure is.
And if you read the Greek rendering of that, it said a few minor ailments. Few minor ailments. Isn't that sad? Well, the sad part of it about it is still going on today. They don't realize Jesus is still preaching. Now, let's go then back to the book of Matthew. We were in chapter 4. Let's go to chapter 9. Matthew 9. I perceive what somebody just said. How come you think Brother Copeland was late today? Who said I was? Steps of a righteous man are ordered to the Lord.
That's right. That's right. Uh-huh.
Oh. I don't know all the reasons why the elevator didn't show up. I don't care.
That's right.
Why, Brother Cobra? Hey, now wait a minute, baby. Let me help you for something here. I don't know what the devil had planned for me, but he missed.
Amen.
Amen. You know what? I'm a happy man. It'd take a whole lot more than a stuck elevator to get me upset. Now, I used to. I'd have been kicking on the door of that elevator, shouting at the thing. I was reminding Gloria of a situation that she and I knew about years ago. We were back there, in the 70s, and the power of God was called a Jesus movement. Well, it's still a Jesus movement. All of it's a Jesus movement. But it was known by that. Man, them hippies is getting saved, getting delivered from dope and everything else you can think of, you know. And we're winning people on the streets and all that kind of thing. Man, it was a big time. We got on the elevator to Full Gospel Businessmen's Fellowship Convention. I wasn't present in that elevator, but people on that elevator were and told Gloria and me about it that evening after it occurred. They got on the elevator to go down to the meeting, and that elevator just stopped. Clunk, clunk, and just quit. It's just full of Holy Ghost baptized, tongue-talking Christians, and they're saying, "Oh God, what are we going to do? Oh, it's Satan going to crash and kill us."
Oh, man.
Well, man, they didn't have no teaching. I mean, hey, all this come later. They did like all the rest of it, man. I mean, you know, we didn't know anything. There was this kid on there, you know, he got hair about this long, and he got a cross hung around his neck on a leather string that's about that big. He's standing there, he got this big old Bible in his hand, and he said, "This looks like a job for the Holy Ghost." He commanded that elevator to run in the name of Jesus. That thing went clunk, 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 and run right on down the bottom floor. And he had a big smile on his face. See, he hadn't heard none of that trash, man. I mean, last thing he heard was, "Oh, yeah. Boy, dude, this is good, ain't it?" That man, he come off of the street. "It looked like a job for the Holy Ghost." And Savelle, probably the one that won him to the Lord. Oh, man, I tell you what, we had fun and we still having fun.
Yes, sir.
Doing what? Preaching the gospel of the kingdom. Now, Matthew chapter 9, verse 35. I can just see that kid. Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing every sickness, every disease among the people.
Glory.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Now, same thing is in force. The words that I speak unto you are not my own. It's the Father that dwelleth within me. He does the works. I can do nothing of myself, but my Father has shown me what I must say and what I must do. I only say what I hear Him say. I only do what I see Him do. Anybody believe it? There it is. Amen. There ain't nothing ever changed. You can't change the process. That process began the day God created the heavens and the earth. God said, "Light be, light was." The Spirit of God was moving on the face of the deep. Amen?
Amen?
God told Moses what to say and what to do. He said it and did it, and it worked. He told him what to say and do, and he didn't do it. God went ahead and gave the water anyway, but got him in trouble. Why? He made up something on his own. It came out of his temper. He got mad at people and shot his mouth off. Instead of saying what God told him to say. God told him what to say at the Red Sea, told him what to do. He said it, did it. There you go. Huh? All right, see, that's the kingdom process. Can't change it. Satan can't change it. All he can do is an attempt to manipulate it. The sower soweth the word. These are laid by the wayside where the word is sown. Satan cometh immediately to steal the word. See, the word's what he's after. He don't care nothing about you. He hates your guts, live or die. He don't care whether you go to heaven or hell. Just get you out of the way. But I'll tell you this. He is extremely afraid of you. You are a carrier. You're the body of Christ. Translated. Anointed. You're a carrier. You have dwelling within you the power to remove burdens and destroy yokes. You can tear up what it took him 50 years to build. You can tear it up in 50 seconds. And if he can't distract you and get your attention, he can't stop you. That's what he's trying to do. He's trying to manipulate that process. He can't change it because it is the kingdom process. This is the way heaven functions all the time. It's the way earth was created and set up to function. It's always been this way. Always will be this way.
Glory.
Kanye Mahoma, sir. Befridio, okay. Why? This will give you some insight. Why is it some angel other than Satan? Let's talk about. Let's go out there beyond the millennium and, you know, and all that and everything. And new heaven, new earth, full of angels, right? Yeah. Why can't some angel get the hot idea that Satan had when he was Lucifer? Because I'm telling you, he was the anointed cherub. It wasn't because he was stupid. Bible said he was perfect in the day he was created, and iniquity was found in him. He started a war. Listen, the war didn't begin on earth. No. He started a war in heaven, and God took care of his sorry self. He kicked him out of there, and it wasn't any easy thing to do. It was a war. Don't ever get in a war with God.
No, sir.
They're going to send your saddle home, brother. You're done. You're through. How come an angel can't do that in the future? Need I say more? You know what this is? It's not just word. It's law. Amen.
Amen.
No. We live under the law of love. That angel doesn't. See, this was not in force at the time Satan did what he did. It is now.
Amen.
The very thought. Wow! Some big old jailer angel walk up to him and slam a hook in his jaw. And I want you to know something. There ain't no forgiveness for a spiritual machine. What do you do with machines? You turn them off. Are you listening to me? That's the reason God went so far as to do this. And he proved it in the earth in spiritual combat with Satan, and Jesus defeated him with it. And men have been exalted to be like God with it.
Yes. Yes,
amen.
Amen.
And ain't no angel ever, 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 and no man ever. There'll be natural men from now on. Once you and I are glorified, that's the end of the glorified ones. There won't be no more of those. No, we it. Aren't you glad you were born in this? Glory to God. Yeah, aren't you glad you got born again in this? Oh, yeah. We're going to just be walking down the street, and there'll be some people standing there and say, oh, look at there, look at there, look at there, look at there. Oh, thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Lord God. There's some of them glorified ones. I ain't never seen one up close of you. Every time I see them, they always up there praising God. Here come two of them now. Maybe they tell us some stories, man. Tell us about Jesus.
Tell us about when they was on the earth. And oh, look at that one. Look at that one. Look at that. Look at all them scars on him. Oh, man, he's been through some battles, hadn't he?
Reckon he'd talk to us.
Yeah, we talk to you. You got a couple of years? Sure, we ain't going nowhere. Sit out here, we'll talk 400 or 500 years. Praise God. But that's only 4 or 5 days.
That's all right.
Are you listening?
Yes.
Think about it. This time we're in right now, this 90, 100, 110, 120 years on the earth, baby, this is the shortest time you will ever be anywhere.
That's exciting.
What is it, Brother Moore says? Soon and very soon. Yeah, soon and very soon. All this is going to change. You're going to change. Amen. Hallelujah. I got to get back to my business here. Thank you, Lord. Well, you started then. Amen. Preaching the gospel of the kingdom. Now then, let's go. Mark chapter 1. Mark 1. And let's look at the 14th, 15th verses. Now, after that John was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. Well, now that brings us to this point. What is the gospel? Most Christians think they know, but you pin them down, they ain't got a clue. Even the things you think it is are all just part of it. Some of you got that look on your face again. Oh, where he been? I've been reading the book. Now, let's go over to the book of Luke, chapter 4. Now, this is the message. Excuse me. The scripture says that Jesus preached this gospel. He published it throughout all Judea. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power, who went about doing good, healing all oppressed of the devil. So now what we're about to see here in Luke 4:18 is the text that he took and from which he preached the gospel of the kingdom. And this gives us a strong clue right here. 18th verse of Luke 4. Verse 17, excuse me. There was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah. When he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written. So he specifically, on purpose, went to a specific chapter and verse in the book of Isaiah, and he read specific words, and he stopped at a specific point. From that point where he stopped, that scripture was beginning to speak to the body of Christ, which was yet to come. See, all prophetic utterance is God calling things that be not as though they were.
That's right.
And when we take that, we begin to say what he said, then we're a part of that coming to pass. Now, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach. Well, he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach. Now, see where it says, sent me? What does that mean? Can you think of a word? Yeah, ordained's a good word. Huh? Appointed is a good word. Apostle was the word I was looking for. Because see, an apostle means all these things. But we never translated the word apostle, and we just kind of glide through there and don't even see it. But you read over in the third chapter of the book of Hebrews, the first verse, and said, he is the apostle and high priest of our confession. God sent him to be the apostle and high priest of our profession or confession. That he, the word there, translated confession, translated is also profession, literally means to say the very same thing. He is the high priest of our saying only what we hear him say and doing only what we see him do. He said, he that hath my commandments, or he that hears what I tell him to do, and he keeps it or does it, he it is that loves me, my Father will love him, I will love him, I'll manifest myself to him. Now that's the very same thing. The words that I'm speaking here to you today, by faith, I say it. And I'm committed to it. I only say what I hear him say and only do what I see him do. Then what? Well, he manifests himself to me. So it is the Lord Jesus Christ in command of the body of Christ. So what? It is the Father that dwelleth within. He does the works. It's the same process. It has never changed. Satan has, like I said, manipulated it, but we're back where we're supposed to be. Amen. Amen. Now, the grace of God's part of this gospel is that he has given us the same spirit. We were born again. Our inner man is born of the Word of God. May I ask you a question? How did Jesus get into this earth? He's born of the Word, right? The Word was the seed in Mary's womb. Well, I got news for you. The Bible said that the Holy Ghost hovered over her and a holy thing was conceived in her. When you said, Jesus, you're my Lord, the Holy Ghost hovered over you and you were born again, not of corruptible seed, but by incorruptible, by the Word of God, which lives and abides forever. And there was conceived inside your physical body. There was conceived in you a new creature in Christ Jesus, born of the Spirit of the living God, identical to Jesus that was raised from the dead. Not the one born in Mary's womb, the one raised from the dead by the Word of God. Yeah.
Praise you, Father God.
Now, yes, sir. He anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He sent me to heal the brokenhearted. He sent me to preach deliverance to the captives. He anointed me and sent me to preach recovering of sight to the blind. He anointed me and sent me to set at liberty them that are bruised. He anointed me and sent me to preach the acceptable year of the Lord, and he closed the book. And he said, this day is this scripture or this gospel fulfilled in your ears. You know, Brother Copeland, we need to preach what Jesus preached. Okay, I'll go along with that. So what did he preach? Every tub got to set on its own bottom. Well, you know, like Jesus said, yeah, the saints need to lie down with the leper. Keith heard somebody preaching that, and I looked it up, and that's what they said. And the others sat there and said, oh, yeah, ha, ha, mm-hmm. Yeah, just like Jesus said. Well, you know, do what Jesus would do. I need to find out what Jesus did if I'm going to do what Jesus did before I put on the bracelet. Well, that's wonderful and all of that, but this is a slogan. It's nothing. What did he do? Only what he saw his father do. Yeah, but what was that? Read the book. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Now then, my Leroy clock just went off, so I will put this into your heart, in your mind. Preached the gospel. Now, what did he say? We know he preached the blessing of Abraham. All they had ever heard was the law. He came preaching the blessing of Abraham. And remember what Creflo's talking about this morning? I had people come say the same thing to me. They said, Brother Copeland, see, I started preaching this in latter part of 1967. And they come and say, you just give people a license to sin. And I didn't know what to say to that, but the Spirit of God rose up in me and answered it. He said, no, they sin without a license.
Yeah, I heard that.
They sin before the license, during the license, after the license. And then this came up on the inside of me, and Creflo stirred it up in me again this morning by the Holy Ghost, and all of those things began to reverberate in my spirit. The middle of last year, coming into this year, I've been studying and reaching. There is a command that Peter wrote to the body of Christ. I'm not going to tell you. You've got to read both books of Peter, 1st and 2nd Peter, to find it. I'll give you that much. It's in either 1st or 2nd Peter. There is a command to grow in the grace of God. You get enough grace working in your life, there's no habit can stand up against it. There's no sin can stand up against it. You get grace working in your life, all this stuff that was so hard for you will just melt off of you like a snowball in August. Amen. It's glorious. Jesus said, yes, sir. Thank you. I can't move away from this without saying this to you. The Lord said to me in 1967, first part of 1968, I inquired of him about this, about what I'm hearing people say, you just preach that grace stuff and people just go wild on sin. I said, Lord, what about that? And here's what the word of the Lord came to me saying. And he taught it to me through the scripture first, and then he said this to me, no born-again child of God is trying to sin and get away with it. He said they're trying to get out of it, and they get caught in it and roped in it, and they have a lot of trouble with it. Why? Because of sin consciousness. That's just exactly what Brother Creflo and Bill and Jerry and Jesse and all the rest of us have been preaching all this time. But it's time now. God has brought the grace of God up like he did years ago with faith and the righteousness of God. Boy, he had turned the big light on the grace of God. Why? It is time for grace, all grace, to abound towards you. And it abounds when people preach it.
Hallelujah.
And that's what Jesus was preaching in the kingdom of God. He went back to the way God dealt with Abraham, not the way God dealt with Moses, and he reintroduced the grace of God. And instead of his saying, my burden is heavy and my load is heavy and you're going to have to suffer to serve me, That's what we've been taught. You ask most preachers what it's like to serve Jesus, they'll tell you about all the stuff they lost. Jesus said, no, baby. He said, my burden's light. My yoke's easy. Easy yoke means there ain't no load on it. Amen. What if you were a little Shetland pony? Some of you don't know what a Shetland pony is. It's a little bitty midget horse that I wanted all my life. I want me one of them little horses. Amen. And little Shetland pony. And this great big wagon load of rocks. And they bring you up there and they stick that harness on you and put you up there. And man, I mean, your little old feet are just going and you're humping against that yoke. Even the birds don't fly off of the rocks. Pee-wee trying to pull this 4-ton load. And this little horse ain't much bigger than a dog. He ain't got no power. But then somebody come walking up there with one of them big old Clydesdales. And back that huge rump on that thing. Them great, I mean, that horseshoe on that thing looked like a mule collar, you know. Oh, man. And they back him up into that harness. And they hook him all up all over. And they bring the tree down on the hill like this. And they hook that big old Clydesdale in that harness next to you. You little Shetland rascal. You little peewee. But you know what God called you? Super horse. You got the same heart in you that Clydesdale got in him. And the boss said, yeah, my man, and your little feet dig in that gravel. And ain't nothing happening. Finally, it is on that. Forget this. That big old Clydesdale bows his old head, whoom, and just walks off with that load. And your little feet are just dangling up there, and you're just going, ah, watch us pull it load. Watch us pull it load. You couldn't even pull the harness. You'll finally come to the place where you're going to believe the grace of God. And God's going to say, come here, a super horse. Come here. You can do all things in Christ who strengthens you. Uh-huh. In your mind, you are Clydesdale.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I am just like Jesus. You are. He didn't depend on himself either, Doc. He let the Father pull it. He's going to back up in there. And you're going to look up and say, hey, big brother. He's going to say, yeah, little bitty buddy. How you doing? I'm doing good, sir. We ready to pull this load? Amen. Let me get my feet up. Don't want to be dragging my feet here. And Jesus just go to trotting off with your load. My yoke is easy. My load is light. All you got to do, baby, is say what I tell you to say. And our Father will do the work. The Father is the one that created that Clydesdale. Amen. Ain't nothing too big for God. Somebody say amen. Hallelujah. Glory, 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 glory. Jesus just simply said this, and we'll get into this later. He simply said this. Poor man, you don't have to be poor no more. I'm here. Sick man, you don't have to be sick no more. I'm here. Heartbroken, you don't have to be brokenhearted anymore. I am here. What is that? That's good news, partner. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Blind man, you don't have to be blind no more. I'm here. That's good news. That's the good news to the blind man. That's the good news to the broke man. That's the good news to the brokenhearted. That's the good news. And he's preaching the acceptable year of the Lord. I'm the Jubilee. I'm the Jubilee. I'm the Jubilee. All the debt is wiped out. All that Satan stole from you is back in your family again. I am the Jubilee. Somebody blow the horn. Come on, get up and shout amen, somebody. Hallelujah. Woo! Glory, glory, glory.